Hi there. Thank you for tuning in to this Sundance Film Festival Beyond Film panel presented by the Roxie Theater in San Francisco. My name is Kelly Wiggin, and I'm the operations manager here at the Roxie. We have, of course, been closed since last March, but we remain committed to presenting great works of art and wonderful conversations in the virtual space. We're thrilled to have been selected as the Northern California satellite screen for the 2021 Sundance Film Festival, and we're so excited to present 12 festival features at our drive-in overlooking the San Francisco Bay at Fort Mason. This panel, The Afterlife of Home Movies, is presented with the Center for Home Movies, and this presentation is a fundraiser for them. To those of you who already donated when you reserved your ticket, thank you so much. There's also a link to donate in the chat. This topic is rather dear to my heart. I studied film and history in school, and as a student I worked at the Pacific Film Archive in Berkeley. I've also volunteered for Home Movie Day Bay Area. Home movies are a perfect nexus of the medium of cinema and the preservation and sharing of our stories. And I'm honored to be in the company, however tangentially, of our panelists today, who will be introduced to you by our moderator, Kate Dollenmayer. Kate is a director of the board at the Center for Home Movies and also works as an archivist at the Academy Film Archive in Hollywood. She previously managed and curated the AV collections of the Venda Museum of the Cold War in Los Angeles, where she presented numerous public programs of home movies and other non-theatrical films. She's also volunteered at Home Movie Days in Los Angeles, Ojai, and Palm Springs, California, as well as Tirana, Albania. Pretty amazing. On behalf of the Roxie, then, I would like to thank each and every one of you for joining us today. You can learn more about our other Beyond Film programs at our website, roxie.com. I really hope you enjoy the panel. And have a great discussion, everyone. And that's all I have to say. Over to you, Kate.
Thank you, Kelly, and welcome, everybody. Thank you all so much for being here. I'm really looking forward to tonight's program, and I hope, can everyone hear me all right? Let me know if you can't. As Kelly said, my name is Kate Dollenmayer, and I'm speaking to you from Los Angeles, which is located on the traditional, ancestral, and contemporary lands of the Tongva, Keech, and other indigenous peoples. What we have planned for this evening is that I'll be giving some brief introductions, then we'll have about 50 minutes of presentations from our four stellar panelists, including film clips, then we'll have about half an hour at the end for discussion, so definitely stick around for that. First, I have just a few points of housekeeping to go over. We are recording, but the chat will not be made publicly available. We encourage you to use the chat to say hello right now and to pose questions throughout the program, and we'll gather those and do our best to answer as many as possible during the Q&A. If you prefer not to have your name read aloud along with your question, you can simply change your display name to attendee in Zoom. To do this, click on the three dots in the upper right-hand corner of your video and choose rename. Or another option is you can just write, I prefer to remain anonymous, in front of your question in the chat. It's a pretty large meeting. It's so nice to see you all here. And even if we can't see you on video, we know there are a lot of friends here and we hope new friends and we can feel your presence. We really appreciate your being here. We ask everybody to abide by Sundance's community agreement, which encourages, in their words, a freely flowing discourse anchored in mutual respect. We'll put a link in the chat to the full text of that agreement, but I'll just add briefly here that if you have any concerns, you can text the word conduct, C-O-N-D-U-C-T, to the number 833-500-0420, or you can send an email to conduct@sundance.org. And that information is also in the document that we'll link to. I'm lucky to have the support of Ariel Flinkman from the Roxie Theater, who's here with us in the chat. So if you're having any problems with Zoom, you can send a private message to Ariel as Roxie Theater. You'll see that name in the chat. I'll try to keep an eye on the chat too, but I may not catch things. So best to contact Roxie Theater if you're having any problems. And now I'd like briefly to introduce our program and participants tonight. The Center for Home Movies is a volunteer-run nonprofit organization dedicated to sharing and preserving home movies. And part of our mission is to transform the way people think about home movies. And tonight we're highlighting four projects that do just that. So now I'll introduce our four wonderful panelists who tell you about the projects and share some of the films preserved by them. Candace Ming works at the Smithsonian National Museum of African American History and Culture as a media conservation and digitization specialist. Previously, they were the archivist and project manager at the Southside Home Movie Project. They are currently a director of the board of the Center for Home Movies and of the Association of Moving Image Archivists, known as AMIA, as well as the chair of the AMIA Diversity and Inclusion Fellowship Program Task Force. And Candace, if you wanna pop in for a moment to say hi, hello.
Hi, everybody.
Next is Tania Espinal, who's a cultural heritage conservator who has been working since 2016 in the field of film preservation. Tania is currently in charge of the Archivo Memoria Project at Cineteca Nacional in Mexico City and is head of the collective Día del Cine Casero. Tania, do you want to say hello?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Good night.
Patricia Ledesma Villon worked as a production archival assistant for the 2020 PBS documentary, The Asian Americans, and has processed home movie collections for the Center for Asian American Media's Memories to Light Asian American Home Movies Project. She is currently a graduate student at UCLA's Media Archival Studies Program. Welcome, Patricia.
Thank you, Kate, and thank you to the Roxie Theater for putting this event together. It means a lot to me to be here, and it's so great to see everyone. It feels like I'm actually in a room together, even though we're not in a room together. But yeah, thanks, Kate.
Thanks, Patricia. And finally, Justin D. Williams is a steward of culture and memory and a facilitator of multimedia projects that study personal and communal narratives in order to preserve and elevate their importance in our society. He is the project archivist and manager of the Southside Home Movie Project. Prior to joining SSHMP, he designed and led the digital storytelling initiative on behalf of the Logan Center for the Arts. He designed and co-founded the Production Institute, a program that trains Southside filmmakers in the essential tools and skills needed to tell their stories. Justin has also worked for award-winning companies Cartemquin Films, StoryCorps, City Bureau, and has partnered with dozens of organizations to design and produce digital storytelling projects. Welcome, Justin.
Thanks, Kate. I'm really excited to be here with so many familiar faces, and I can't wait for us all to chat a little bit later.
I think we're just about ready to start the program, but before we do, I want to thank our hosts at Sundance and the Roxie Theater, especially Kelly Wiggin, Ariel Flinkman, and Kate Napoli, as well as my dear fellow Center for Home Movies board members, Pamela Vatican and Amy Sloper, who are here with us in the chat, and Candace Ming. And that's a good place for me to end because Candace is going to kick off our program. I just have one final note. Some portions of the film clips are silent, so don't worry that your audio stopped working. It's all gonna be great, silent or sound. So now, without further ado, I hope you enjoy the program and we'll see you back here for our conversation in just under an hour.
Hi, my name is Candace Ming and I am a media conservation and digitization specialist at the National Museum of African American History and Culture in DC. And I'm here to talk about the Great Migration Home Movie Project. The Great Migration Home Movie Project is a unique digitization service that invites members of the general public to schedule an appointment with our audiovisual conservation team and have their media digitized for free. We're located on the second floor of the museum, and anyone can bring in any type of media. They drop it off during the day, we digitize it and return it to them on a USB stick. So the GMHMP initiative is a partnership between the Earl W. and Amanda Stafford Center for African American Media Arts and the Robert F. Smith Center for the Digitization and Curation of African American History. through the Robert F. Smith Center. The program travels across the country, partnering with local archives to perform digitization and training services. The Robert F. Smith Center also runs the Explore Your Family History Center, where you can set up a meeting with a genealogist to trace your family tree. We also do flat object scanning when we're on the road, and we run a robust internship and fellowship program. So far, GMHMP has had a huge impact in revealing the hidden histories and personal lives of everyday people of African American descent. Canonically, we're left out of American history, and I think that home movies are a great way not to just show personal narratives, but also often show historic moments from the lives of people who lived it. So, as I mentioned before, these are our digitization capabilities. This applies both in the museum and on our digitization truck, which is what we take on the road. So video, we can do pretty much any home movie or consumer format, as well as some professional formats like U-matic and half inch open reel, 1 inch open reel. Film is the same. We can do any amateur film format as well as 35. And then audio. We also do audio. We get oral histories from people, songs people have written, and we can do cassettes, quarter inch open reel. We recently got a DAT machine. We can do LPs in the museum as well as optical disc formats like CDs, DVDs, that kind of thing. So the impact so far is huge. We have 100+ family collections in our study collection. I would say we have about 800+ material that we've digitized since the project started in 2016. And that includes not just family home movies, but also material from partner institutions. And this is a rough estimate of hours of content. Everyone asks for hours, but it's hard with all the different formats. I would say at least 1500, probably more hours of footage, both from home movies again and from partner institutions. The left picture is from our truck, where we can actually do 4 video transfers at once. So the reach too has been steadily increasing. We were featured in Driving While Black, Race, Space, and Mobility in America last year. Prior to that, in Smithsonian Channel's The Green Book Guide to Freedom. We're getting requests from people who want to use footage from the Great Migration Home Movie Project every day. And we do our best to meet those needs. You know, the donors retain the rights. The Smithsonian doesn't have rights to the footage. People who are featured on our website have signed a license agreement with us to be featured on our finding aid. My head is kind of covering up the slide here, but in 2020, especially with everything going virtual, we did a lot of online exhibitions and programs through the Exploratorium in San Francisco, through NYU's Orphan Film Symposium, and through New York Queen's Memory Project for Home Movie Day in October. And we have more coming up this year as well. So I love this quote by bell hooks. When we concentrate on photography, we make it possible to see the walls of photographs in Black homes as a critical intervention, a disruption of white control over Black images. so much of media and history is controlled by white authors, writers, and it leads to so many stereotypes that are prevalent about the Black community. And I think home movies, although her quote is actually talking about photos, I do think home movies are, like what she said, a critical intervention in letting African Americans tell our own history in our own way. And that leads me into a little highlight reel I put together. And I think you'll see that it illustrates how home movies illuminate history from the incredibly personal to the monumental. African-American home movies shine a spotlight on often hidden communities and provide a window into the lives of everyday people, as well as groundbreaking historic moments. So I'm just going to run the clip.
Talk about a tear that's looking high, and she prayed for his kingdom, his world. Talk about a child that loves everybody. He sees. Thank you.
I hope you enjoyed that. These are our links. I hope to distribute the slides later, but it features links to the websites of both centers that I mentioned, our Finding Aid, where you can watch the films online, and our main page on NMOC's website that showcases our services and lets people know how to schedule an appointment. Right now we are not doing appointments because of COVID. The museums are closed, but if you want to learn more about us, feel free to email us. And finally, get in touch. If you have any further questions, here's my email, mingc@si.edu. Love to hear from you, and thank you very much.
Hello there, my name is Tania Espinal. I'm a conservator of cultural heritage, currently working as a head of the Archivo Memoria Project in Cineteca Nacional, and also head of the annual celebration of the Home Movie Day, or Día de Cine Casero, in Cineteca Nacional, and since 2019 in Guadalajara, Jalisco, at the ITESO. Archivo Memoria is a project that started in 2010 by Paula Astorga and Audrey Young, among other colleagues as Micael Ramos, Roger Mendoza, Ezequiel Reyes, Veronica Navarro, and Naomi. The main purpose of this project is the preservation, digitization, cataloging, and open access of the small gauge formats. We work with 16 millimeters, 9.5 millimeters, 8 millimeters, and Super 8. Most of these films are home movies, experimental cinema, and amateur documentaries. The project is open to all public who want to donate their films to be a part of Cineteca Nacional Film Archive and contributing to the National Film Heritage. We inspect, digitize, catalog, and archive the films on vaults and storage them on archival cans. And then we gave a copy of the media to the donating families, allowing films to have a new life for everyone to access and also to share with your family. The materials can be used for reappropriation, research, exhibits, documentaries, etc. Archivo Memoria has 120 collections with more than 1,500 films dating from 1923 to 2012. We started to organize Home Movie Day celebration in Cineteca Nacional on the 2015. In 2020, we made this online, and the participants share us an audio clip with a brief story of their films, and it was so touching. You can check this link online on YouTube. On this event, we asked the public to bring along their family and amateur films on 16, 8, and Super 8 to share these captured moments and fragments of memory on a big screen and freely exchange their experiences and family stories. Home movies are unique. Most of the times, they do not have a negative, just a positive version. During the event, we gave the attendants advice on how to correctly store their films and encourage them to approach professionals when they were not able to properly do so. Most of the times, because they lack of the complex technical procedures or lack of resources for the correct preservation. My main activities on this special day are the film inspection and projecting the film. With this project, we can share our knowledge about film handling and rediscovering emotional and historic values. Home movies and amateur films are essential elements for our audiovisual heritage. They are a real reference regarding to the historical context and sociocultural environment in a specific community. Working close to the families and individuals gets you to know them, entering the intimacy or privacy of these films, thus allowing them to be shared with another narrative, aesthetic, or symbolic values.
Hi, I'm gonna pop here. Here is Xochimilco, the south of Mexico City, and it's a typical trip to go on a Sunday and enjoy with your family. So this is the collection of José Urraca Cristóbal that it's part of the Archivo Memoria Project. And José Urraca was an Spanish exile from the Civil War, and he has such a good life here in Mexico with his family. And also he had a diary where he puts a number on the cans of the films and describe the event. Like in this film, he described like who was on the trajinera and what were they eating and everything. So it's a beautiful collection from Archivo Memoria. Here is Barrancas del Cobre in Chihuahua, in Mexico, and it's on the north of Mexico. So you can see the changes on the view. And here is another collection from the Gómez Monterrubio, and they were from Tampico. So it will pass another film, and they are at the beach, I think. And here's again the Urraca family, and they are at the Teotihuacan pyramid playing and having fun on the 1959. And here's Mitla in Oaxaca, and the José Urraca, this is the one that films all the movies, and he was like a comic. And here is in the border with the US and Mexico. It's called Playa Washington, I think. And it's in Tampico. So they are having like this picnic at the beach. And you can see also the fashion on the 60s. And I don't know, the family told me about everything on the films when I get the digital. Mm-hmm. And here is the celebration of the Home Movie Day at the ITESO, where we inspect. We didn't digitize because we don't have the machines to do that, but we do the projection. So people bring us their cans and we stabilize the films and then project them. And there was a time where a girl gave us the only film she has, and she told us that was the only image that she has of his father, and the only way that her daughter had to know the granddad. So it was like a very touching moment for the whole movie day at that day. This is a 15 años party. And here we can see the damage on the film. That it's also artistic, kind of. And this is a black and white film. It was an 8mm from Guadalajara. It was filmed on the city. Thank you for listening, and thank you for inviting me to this experience. If you have any questions or doubts or whatever, please feel free to contact me. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Patricia Ledesma Villon, and I worked as a production archival assistant for the 2020 PBS documentary, The Asian Americans, for the Center for Asian American Media, otherwise known as CAAM, and simultaneously processed home movie collections for Memories to Light, CAAM's Asian American Home Movie Project. Memories to Light started in 2013 with a goal to make Asian American home movies accessible to a broader public. Since 2013, Memories to Light has worked with over 40 families to digitize their films and share the knowledge of home movie film preservation. The overall importance of this project is to celebrate these Asian American experiences, not only within the Asian American community, but to share these stories with wider contemporary dialogues on narrative, storytelling, and the collective remembrance of the past. Amateur cinema and home movies allow underrepresented communities not only to be represented on camera, but give communities the autonomy to dictate how they are represented, when they are represented, and be the creators and subjects of their own stories. We'll take a look at an oral history video with Don Boholano Mabalon, a professor of history at San Francisco State University, whose work focused on the history of Filipino Americans and Filipinos in Stockton, California, where she was born and raised. Don passed away in 2018. However, Don's story lives forever thanks to the oral histories conducted within Memories to Light. Now we'll share her and her community's story, see some clips from her family's home movies, and take a look at a short compilation of home movies from Home Movie Day in 2018. Enjoy.
My grandmother has her three grandchildren around her. I mean, there would eventually be seven, but it's myself, my cousin Jared, my cousin Ariane. I think it's her birthday. She must have been 2. And she kisses all of us. It was just this really sweet exchange. And I think she's in her 50s at this point. We're in my house on Jefferson Street, my parents' house. And it's this really sweet moment of my grandmother being very affectionate with us. And she was a really tough woman. You know, she very strict, had high expectations of us, and to, you know, and very funny and loving. Stockton was the home to the largest community of Filipinos outside of the Philippines through much of the 20th century. It's one of the reasons why my grandfathers chose to settle in Stockton when they came in 1929. And on my mother's side, my grandfather went into the Philippines and fought in World War II in the 1st Philippine Infantry Regiment, married my grandmother, Concepcion Moreno, that brought her over, and it was Stockton that they all chose to settle in. It was where their other relatives were. It was where Little Manila was, which was this big ethnic neighborhood in downtown Stockton. You know, so it was this very warm and close-knit community. Where we lived in Stockton was on the south side of Stockton, and the south side was the side where all the people of color lived. It was a very, very segregated city. And that was something I didn't really realize until I was 6 years old and was bused in the school desegregation busing program to the other side. And I realized, oh, this is where all the white people are, and this is where all the nice houses are, and the malls and the shopping areas. When we were younger, we were excluded from so much of white Stockton and so much of middle class and upper middle class Stockton. We really created our own world. In the South Side and in downtown Stockton and in Little Manila. By the time I was born, Little Manila had been destroyed. But it's this incredible community that they create, this community of family who may have been distant in the Philippines but are close as brother and sister here in the United States. You really have to start over in America and create a new family. And the people who may not have been so close to you, third, fourth, fifth cousins, somebody who lived down the block in the Philippines, are suddenly as close as your blood. We all grew up generally the same side of town. But my family, we all lived within a 1 mile radius of each other. It was this community where you really couldn't get into much trouble because everybody's always watching you. You know, so you walk down the block and, hey, where are you going? You know, or, oh, I saw you trying to go to McDonald's and get ice cream and you're not supposed to leave the house. You see this flourishing of the Filipino American community after it had gone through so much hardship. From the 19-teens up till after World War II. And I'm not necessarily gonna say it was a golden age. I mean, Filipinos are still segregated to the south side of Stockton. The high schools and the public schools I went to were still some of the worst funded schools in the city. I mean, you could feel a lot of hope and a lot of promise. The fact that they could now become citizens, they could buy land, they could find jobs, and they couldn't do any of those things before World War II. Many Filipinos thought that they would work in the fields and then finish college later, you know, or work in the fields in the summer times and then finish college. But the Depression really dashed all of those dreams. And for my father's father, Pablo Mabalo, he worked in the fields, but he had had restaurant experience. And so he opened up a restaurant in Little Manila. That became an institution for Filipino farm workers and people coming through Stockton and living in Stockton. His restaurant served as a post office and a bank and a community center. He had it until 1983. It was one of the longest Filipino restaurants probably in the nation. And so when Filipinos were going on strike in the 20s and the 30s, my grandfather fed them for free. Carlos Bulosan went to eat at my grandfather's restaurant and he ate for free all the time because he never had any money. He was an organizer. He was a writer, you know, he was an activist, and my grandfather had a very kindly heart. He never would turn anyone away. My mother's father, Delfin Boholano, he worked in the fields when he first came in 1929. He worked as a boilermaker in Mare Island. He was an aspiring boxer. He fought in World War II. Both he and my grandmother went to college on the GI Bill. They had their college educations. My grandfather in business administration, my grandmother in education. my grandmother as a war bride came to America in 1952, they didn't realize how bad racism would still affect their careers and their life choices. So my grandfather was a farm labor contractor until the end of his life. My grandmother eventually became one of the first Filipina teachers in the San Joaquin Delta area. When my father came in 1963, he came with a college education, he came with a medical degree, but Filipinos were not given opportunities to work in the medical field. That didn't come for another 5 to 10 years, that you had massive immigration of more nurses and doctors and medical professionals. And so my father worked in the fields. That was really the only place that Filipinos could find work. One of his friends who was part of his fraternity was Larry Itliong, who started the Delano grape strike. And so they all knew each other. And Stockton was really this hub for farm labor activism and farm labor activists. And all those unions really have their roots in Stockton. They were my uncles and my family's cousins. And, you know, it was really, this work in the fields was really seen as very dignified work. It was a tragedy that those who had educations could not move beyond the fields. But that was why they put that hope on our generation. I feel that growing up in Stockton, I didn't ask enough questions. That's one of the reasons why I decided to research and teach Filipino American history and then write the book about Stockton. I look through the films and seeing all the people who, you know, and all the different celebrations, whether it was my grandfather's 50th birthday, which was the earliest home movie that we have, that gathering at my grandparents' house in 1958, they had just bought that house 3 years prior, and seeing them surrounded with so much love and all of their, you know, cousins and townmates and friends that they had made in Northern California all coming together, seeing my mom as an 11-year-old girl doing the jitterbug with her older brother, and all of that hope, really, for their life in America. Imagining what they had hoped for us by leaving and settling in Stockton and trying to make a life for themselves and working so hard. I really feel blessed.
Say a few words. You're going to be in the movie. Best wishes for your baby, Auntie Wendy. Best wishes. Just say hi. Say hello, everybody.
Hello and good evening, everyone. I want to extend a very large thank you to the Center for Home Movies and the Roxie Theater. To our film donors, supporters, and friends of the project, we made it to Sundance. It's my honor to represent the Southside Home Movie Project. The topic that I'll be presenting on today is, what use is a home movie archive? My name is Justin Williams, and I am the project manager and archivist of the Southside Home Movie Project. We are led in this work by Professor Jacqueline Stewart, our director, as well as the Chief Artistic and Programming Officer at the Academy Film Museum. Our team is small but mighty and also includes project manager Sabrina Craig and a graduate intern Avery LaFlamme, each of which have played a crucial role in our signature programming, Spinning Home Movies. I want to reflect on the question posed in the title of this presentation. Though rarely put this directly, it is one that I feel constantly confronts me in the field of memory preservation in general. Preserve for what? What is its value? And since we're American, let's cut to it. What is its use? If it feels like a charged question, it is because it is. Our society has a memory problem. As National Youth Poet Laureate Amanda Gorman put it, it's the hill we climb. It's because being American is more than a pride we inherit. It's the past we step into and how we repair it. Memory is at the core of how we build our identities. From it, we make meaning and tell stories about ourselves, our families, and our communities. When memory is lacking, our narratives are left lacking too. Stories are told without substance, complexity, voice, and even the choices we make. How then can we step into today? To repair requires us to remember. At the Southside Home Movie Project, we have long been fascinated by the power of memory. We began our work in 2005 as a new archival model for encouraging local residents to recognize the value of their home movies and to build a publicly accessible archive for creative projects and scholarly work. We launched our digital archive in 2017 to create online access to our entire collection, and in 2019, we were honored by the Association of Moving Archivists with the Ray Edmondson Advocacy Award in recognition of those community engagement efforts. So I pose again this question, which we all had to reckon with in 2020. Though we at the Southside Home Movie Project, like so many others, found ourselves physically distanced from our communities and our work, we pivoted quickly to the new realities and stumbled upon new models we couldn't have foreseen. I hope that I can illustrate through some select examples of our work in 2020, how our home movie archive spliced together reels from the past to offer connection, acknowledgement, and healing to our present. When COVID pushed us remote, we could still access our film collections thanks to our publicly accessible digital archive. Through the online portal, artists, researchers, and students could still reach us and explore our home movie collections. Since we are at a film festival, I wanted to highlight two film projects that incorporated our archival films and were lucky enough to catch the zeitgeist at that particular time. We worked with the producers of Rick Burns' Driving While Black throughout the year, and by its premiere in October 2020, this in-depth exploration of African Americans on the road had become an even more meaningful acknowledgement of the very real danger and precarity Black motorists continue to face, while also inviting us to experience the freedom of mobility that vehicles make possible, particularly in this moment of lockdown. This documentary features clips from our collections to illustrate this. Late last fall, we were contacted by another film project, Sylvie's Love, which first premiered at Sundance a year ago. It's a touching film about a Black couple that falls in love and builds a life during the age of jazz, early television, and the 1950s. The filmmakers revisit a world long gone and wanted to use home movies to encourage folks to visit again. Selections from our archive can be seen in their promotions on Instagram. Thank you. Over the years, an important part of our mission has also been to engage our communities through the familiar experience of watching home movies together, with family members narrating, music playing, and generations sharing stories. Beyond mere nostalgia, the quote above from our director Jacqueline Stewart explains our intention and how we seek to accomplish the act of archiving in public, for the public. We wanted to bring home movies back home, recreating the warmth and intimacy of watching them live with friends and family, which led us to create Spinning Home Movies. In April 2020, we launched this new series of free public live stream programs that invited Chicago's top DJs, musicians, and spoken word artists to dive into our film archive, find home movie moments that resonated with them, and marry them with sounds in unique and surprising ways. What began as a way to foster connection has since emerged as a new paradigm for meaningful artistic collaboration, bringing contemporary artists, archival material, and expanded viewership together on a globally accessible platform. To date, 13 artists have explored the archive and created a series of soundtracks, each with a unique mix of original music, recorded songs, and audio. The artists and the film donors joined us online for the premiere of each episode. Word spread about the program throughout the spring and summer and received wonderfully positive media attention. The program has garnered more than 1,000 views per episode, with hundreds of viewers, including the home movie donors, family members, and friends and newcomers, joining a lively conversation in the comments. In 2020, like its name pretends, we all learned to look at the world more clearly. Some of what we saw was reflected through Spinning Home Movies. This quote from Jamila Woods, the brilliant Chicago poet and musician with whom we've collaborated this summer, eloquently captures the spirit of our thinking in those early months of quarantine. To remember and to be remembered, these are powerful antidotes to this period of isolation we've all been experiencing and a call to reconnect with one another. With the death of George Floyd and the calls for justice turning to chants and marches and shouts, troops took to our nation's streets to repress uprisings in ways not seen since 50 years ago. Artists called for us to remember that this was not the first lynching of its kind, just the first fully captured on video. And they turned to our archive looking to explain this depth of pain, which had seemingly been erased, as well as moments of rebellion. We turn to our poets to offer a language that could contain the hurtful truth. Babies and tiny children fill the screen, every dimpled knee, gummy grin, and wobbling step filmed with love by watchful parents. In each frame, a reminder that Laquan was somebody's baby, Rakia was somebody's baby, George was somebody's baby. Honore lays her unflinching poetry, honoring black and brown boys and girls of these intimate scenes in collaboration with music producer Rob McKay, offering an unforgettable soundtrack of deep cuts and devastating spoken word.
George called out to his mama, who was 2 years gone, called out with last breath, last plea, last hope, called out to be saved, protected, needed, called out in fear, called for his first safety, his first home, his first love. He called out to all of us, the mothers of brown boys with smiles wide as heaven, mothers whose sons tower above them, and the mothers whose arms long to hold boys that never grew into men. He called out to us, Mama! He called to God, Mama! He called to the earth, Mama! Final cry, then no more. And the mothers answered with rage, with pain, with sorrow, with hundreds of years of murder of their sons and daughters, the mothers answered, burn it all down.
Despite the isolation and uncertainty of this past year, we believe home movies have offered meaningful ways to reach across the distance and connect to our families, neighbors, and communities. Watching these films remind us of how closely our lives and those of others are intimately bound together. By recalling our memories, facing our past, may we repair the harm, apply the balm, and inspire deeper healing and connection moving forward. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was incredibly moving. I want to welcome everyone back. Just take a moment to take a breath. Thank you all so much for these wonderful presentations, Justin, Patricia, Tanya, and Candace. There's so much to talk about here, and we'll jump into the conversation in just a moment, but I want to remind everyone of our community agreement for a respectful discussion that we'll link to in the chat. If someone could help me with that, that would be great. Please feel free to continue typing your thoughts and questions in the chat window. And I think we have time for conversation and hopefully get as many questions from the audience in as possible. So I'll get us started with a few questions, and I want to start with Justin. You started your presentation with the question, preserve for what? And I think you gave one answer when you drew this connection between remembering and repairing. So I'm wondering if you can talk a bit more about that and how that repair has looked in the spaces where you come together to share these films, especially in 2020. And I wonder too, this is maybe a side question that, or companion that we can get to later, but if there have been instances where remembering has actually brought to the surface some kind of pain that had been forgotten or not known. So that's maybe a question for everyone. How do you handle it if home movies bring up painful memories? But yeah, love to start with Justin. Thank you again.
Yeah, thank you. And I'm glad to be here, Kate. Thanks so much. I know that that last part of spinning home movies was exceptionally moving, and I was crying again watching it. I did every time we worked with Leslie, and I'd be remiss not to point out Avery LaFlamme is our brilliant editor of spinning home movies, and he Leslie and Rob just worked magic to really bring up the grief, you know. Grief is love with no place to go. And I believe that applies in the case of the topic that they were going through, which was police murders and the devaluing of Black life. But I think it's also embodied in the larger context, which I really like was, I was like snapping at Patricia's, the oral history that you all recorded was the same way. It's like, we have to talk about how we came to be in this place. And particularly for us, the South Side of Chicago. There's an article that pointed out that Chicago lost 350,000 Black people since 1980, which was 30% of its population. Many people know, and a lot of people know, that Black folks came to Chicago escaping racial violence by the millions to Chicago. And for us, we when we view home movies, this question still comes up, or this grief still comes up, which is, where are we? Where are we now? There's literally cavities on many blocks of the streets of Bronzeville, a neighborhood I live in now, which used to be homes, which used to be families, used to be businesses. And what these home movies allow for is for us to resurrect that past, to remember, to see in like many ways that, you know, that the same, I saw so many connections with Patricia's work of like, despite what we were escaping, we still prospered. And folks want to connect to that, and they want to connect to that sense of home and identity, despite the many ways community is shifting and changing, often without their own control. And so I think that's one purpose, and there's many more, but I don't want to hog the conversation. I'm curious about what other folks have to say.
Yeah, I think that I think it's really important to point out that grief that comes with home movies. I think in contemporary dialogues about home movies, there's always this sense that we have to commemorate the past, and that home movies always document this sort of joy that the past has experienced. But I guess for a lot of communities like the Black community and other communities of color, we've had like difficult pasts. And I was processing a home movie collection that documented a family's experience at a Japanese internment camp during World War II. And that helped me remember that, you know, home movies aren't always joyous celebrations. And I think the critical examination of these like past that we've experienced, I think, is really important for us to remember when we process and work on these important collections.
Yeah, thank you for that. I think also that just reminds me, Justin, you mentioned nostalgia and going beyond nostalgia, and that's something that I heard too. I watched Driving While Black just a few nights ago, and sort of making sure not to conflate remembering with nostalgia. I think that really speaks to what Patricia was talking about. And I wanted to maybe turn to Tania for a moment, because I think, you know, you talked about the Archivo Memoria Project being open to anyone who wants to contribute, but you also talked about the privacy of the films and about getting to know the families. And it seems like this is something that all these projects have in common, is a commitment to kind of making a connection with the makers of the films through oral histories in a lot of these cases and other ways. So a question that anyone, for all of you, but maybe Tania, you could start and talk about outreach and forming those relationships. How do you find the people with the home movies, and how much of your work is outreach? And I know, you know, you talked too about working on Home Movie Day, not only in Mexico City, but also in Guadalajara. And so, yeah, just if you could talk a bit about outreach and the work you do, that would be great.
Yeah, well, the intimacy of the families, it's like they made the petition or the request for the digitization and be a part of the archive. And then we asked them to talk about the collection, like who filmed, in which years, or the topic of the films, kind of. And then the families bring us the films. So we have the chance to speak face to face. And then when I started to digitize and do the inspection, sometimes they go for sign the contract, the donation contract, and then I show them the work that I have done, like a preview, and then they start to talking about the collection, the films, the memories, the nostalgia that we're talking, and just like let open the door of their homes, no, or like they include you in their family, in the center of the family, no, like if you are the granddaughter or whatever. My latest collection, the lady started crying and said to me that everyone on the film was dead, no? So it was like so hard for me, because I put it like in perspective, like if she was my grandmother or whatever. So yeah, it's like one Arturo Ripstein, the filmmaker, donate her his films. And yeah, we have like this private session, and we start he start viewing the film, and he told me like, this is the archaeology of the image. And I was like, these places not longer exist. My family is dead. I didn't remember my dad's face. You know, it's like, was so hard to hear that, like, he forgot about his father's face or the voice of his mother or this thing. So I think of the cultural heritage, and it's so important to share this type of films, and not only the future films, you know, that the institutions preserve. So these other archives are so important to know our culture and to know our communities and the celebrations that we shared and still sharing, like the quinceaños or the parties, vacations or anything. Like I was watching the films, and we all have this dance party, this dancing moment, you know? So we share the same thing, even we are in Mexico or in America or wherever. We are a community, a big community, and that's what we have to preserve, the memory, the common memory.
Yeah, and I think we just happened to have a dance party on screen when someone let us know that it was Justin's birthday today. Is that right? So happy birthday. Thanks for being here on your birthday.
Very happy to be here. Thank you.
Candace, you know, I wanted to ask you about outreach too. And I love the truck, you know, I want to know more about the truck, but if you want to talk about that, and also maybe you could talk a little bit more about some of the clips you showed. And I was thinking about what it means that you're in the collection too, like that, the way that you approach your relationships with the donors must be affected by that too. So, yeah.
Outreach is generally done through a mix of media. When we were in Chicago last year, we worked with Southside Home Movie Project. We worked with DuSable, and we do hope that they'll get the word out to their, you know, listservs and membership. And then also just print media. We did ads, we did radio, we did TV, just saying we're here. And then of course, NMAC itself has a fairly large membership arm and I guess PR arm, who also put it out to their membership, because, you know, our members are across the country. So I know many people who came for appointments had seen it in a member newsletter that we were going to be in Chicago. We were there in September of last year for the whole month. So that's generally how we do outreach for stuff outside of DC. And for appointments at the museum, we try to do Twitter to try and the NMAC Twitter to just be like, drop by for a Great Migration Home Movie Project appointment email. Since it is just an ongoing service, there's no time limitation. And the truck, as Kate says, is a literal truck that has all of our digitization equipment that I talked a little bit about in the presentation, that drives around the country. And we would have been in New Orleans last year. We've hit Chicago, Baltimore, and Denver so far. So we have, we're gonna be in New Orleans, St. Louis, my hometown, and New York as well are some of the three upcoming cities. And I think for me, you know, SSHMP, which I think in my bio I used to work for SSHMP, but SSHMP is so important because it's hyper local and you get such a rich documentation of a community. And I think GMHMP is kind of hitting a different benchmark in that we're not hyper focused, so we try to spread out, especially to communities where there might not be an archive or a place to go to get your films or videos or audio digitized. So I think we're trying to capture the breadth, a larger swath of the African American experience here in the US. And we do try to also, while we're there, tell people, like with SSHMP, anyone who brought in film, I was like, so don't you know about SSHMP, right? You know about, so that they could think about possibly donating their collections, because we don't keep the original material. So we're just keeping a digitized version. So we are trying to and we also do educate if people are uncomfortable, as many often are with donating to an archive, is we do give proper storage tips and how to preserve your items long-term, but yeah.
Yeah, maybe I can just do a quick follow-up, because we had a question from the audience that I think is related, and anyone else can answer this too, but question from B. Curiel. Hi, thanks to all of you for taking the time to put this movies together. I'd like to throw a question for all participants. What strategies have been successful in order to get people to bring and share their home movies in your institutions? So yeah, when Candace, you were talking, I was wondering, do you know, like, were those TV ads, did people tell you they came in from the TV ads or the newspaper?
Yeah, the TV was the radio was the big one, because it was the local NPR affiliate, which most people in Chicago do listen to. We were also in the Chicago Sun-Times and the Reader and the Tribune, I think. So those three, I mean, someone actually brought in the paper once and was like, I saw you here. And we're like, yes, come on in. So I think those are ways you can do it, but that was like very rushed and very on the ground. Whereas I think outreach, we've had success on DC doing home movie days, I think are a really great opportunity to not only let people see their films, but also say, hey, if you bring this back, we'll digitize it as well and give you a digital copy.
Anyone else wanna address that?
On Guadalajara, we put on social media and also in the radio. And also at the community at the university that host us. So that's like the ways. And also Archivo Memoria, when it started, they do spread the word on TV and the news and everywhere. Yep.
For Memories Delight, I think the word, like the power of word of mouth communication is particularly important, because for Stephen Gong, the executive director of CAAM, who founded the project, we got a lot of collections digitized because some of the people were just his neighbors. It also speaks to the fact that not even just for archival projects, you should get to know your neighbors to begin with, but, you know, and then through that, like, word of mouth spread and people were, you know, interested in getting their home movies digitized because they didn't have equipment at home to like access their home movies. And many people hadn't seen their movies in so long. And then also recently, the Memory Select Project got a boost lately because of our work with the PBS documentary, The Asian Americans. So those two components really helped to kind of put the project out there. But yeah, I definitely would like to support the idea that you should get to know your neighbors, and that's a great way to collect a lot of oral histories in your own community.
Yeah, that's actually connected to something I wanted to ask you about, Patricia, that, you know, and maybe related to the distinction Candace was drawing between Southside Home Movie Project on the one hand being this very hyper-local project and the Great Migration Home Movie Project being more dispersed or spread out. But, you know, I think in the oral history from the clip you showed, Don Boholano was talking about how Filipinos in Stockton made their own world, and that really kind of struck me as this kind of great example too, that then that's documented in home movies. So it's this self-made culture that is self-documented also. And, but you also talked about how the mission of CAAM is to bring that media to a wider audience. And so I was sort of wondering if you could talk about what you see as the value of that for that community, and how, you know, what are the kind of particular challenges, especially for marginalized and immigrant communities, of kind of recontextualizing those materials or spreading, you know, bringing them to wider contexts?
Yeah, of course. So Dawn is such a important figure in the Filipino community. She was a professor of history, I think, at San Francisco State University, but most of her work was really informed by the fact that, you know, she was around these seminal Filipino figures such as Carlos Bulosan, who was a notable Filipino author. And we were like, CAAM was really lucky to really get the opportunity to work closely with her and remember her story, because she unfortunately passed away suddenly in 2018. But, you know, thanks to the power of you know, documenting the story and even just sharing her story orally, we're able to remember her story forever in a way, because these are stories that we'll share with the next generation. But then going back to that, I guess, question of representation, I think in like recent years, there's been, I guess, contemporary media has been very interested in sharing, I guess you can say, quote unquote, marginalized stories, but, you know, at what cost is that representation for? Do we want to just continue catering to this ongoing gaze? But with home movies, like I mentioned in my presentation, you know, it gives the community this autonomy to dictate their own story, to create their own stories for themselves. And they have the power to do that. And I think that's what makes amateur cinema and home movies particularly a very important cultural record.
I wanted to share a little bit to that point as well, that I'm hearing in there like a value around authorship and like the connection, the intimate connection from the film you're watching to the film donor or the family or community from which it or what of which it portrays. And we are lucky with Southside Home Movie Project, like Candace says, to like operate in a hyper local way so that we can get these images out. But one of the direct ways we can do that is by programming in the community with partnerships, with community-based organizations, with, you know, sewing circles, you know, you name it, it's probably been tried or done. And bingo night, I know that's a big favorite of Sabrina and Candace's. And, you know, Spinning Home Movies was live before it was, with DJ mixes, before it was a program. These are all ways in which to resurrect this past and nostalgia and sense of community, but then to do it actually, you know? So it's like it's an archive, but it's almost a re-archiving project at the same time. It builds so many more intimate connections and trust, and ultimately creates more opportunities for more collections to come towards us. I saw that there's a question in the chat about how do folks feel being in these documentaries or these films. And we've been lucky enough that everyone is very agreeable, but that's partly because we are not losing relationship with them. We are involving them in our projects. We're keeping them up to date. We're asking them to come speak, to actually be at the center of the conversation. So all of our Spinning Home movies, or most of them, feature or a conversation at the end with a donor of whose collections are in the footage. And there are even some where we have just made that agreement to talk to them before we actually say yes to a project, you know? And that's beyond the legal bounds of what we may need to do, but it's just an ethical bounds, which we try to practice.
And I'll answer on GMH and Peas. As I mentioned in my presentation, NMOC doesn't hold the rights. We get a license agreement to show films and forums like this, but in the case of a documentary producer, Justin talking about ethical bounds, you know, we aren't just giving out their emails to any documentary producer who contacts us. We do kind of act as a barrier to say, do you want to be contacted? Are you interested? And some people are not interested, and we just go, no, they're not interested. You know, you'll have to make do with what you're given. So that's the way that NMOC handles it.
Yeah, in the Cineteca is like the same. We have this policy. In the contract, it specified if the family wants to be asked before they use their films, or just like the head of the archive said, if she agree with the project or not, or whatever, and yeah.
I think for CAAM, it usually varies. Some donors are definitely more willing to be on the spotlight than others, and I think you have to respect that sometimes. I mean, Dawn is obviously a public speaker, so she was of course willing to take that opportunity. But you know, just kind of gauging that relationship, but you know, also build that relationship with your donors, get to know them and who they are as a, you know, member of your community. And I think by doing that, they'll also be willing to open up to you the more you foster that relationship as well.
I know we're already just a few minutes over and we got the go ahead to run a little late, but if anyone has to go, we understand. But there is one or two more questions in the chat that I just wanna try to get to. So if you all are okay to just hang on for a few more minutes, we can keep going. There was a question about protest videos, and I think that was answered in the chat. So maybe we won't take the time to discuss it here, but there were some resources for Witness and Human Rights Watch. Those are great leads and references for that question. And then we have a question from Sofia Arevalo. I would like to ask the opinion of the participants regarding the place of home movies compared to the big formats, 35mm, 16mm, in your archives. And what is the perception of your institution's administration regarding its importance and value of its preservation? I think sometimes it is belittled by the big heads. So I know this doesn't apply to all of you necessarily, but just based on your project, you might only collect home movies, but I know some of you have also worked in other institutions that have both. So if anyone wants to answer that, Tania, maybe you have some insight. Yeah,
I think it's a continuous struggle to preserve this type of films. As I said before, if it's not a feature film, it's harder, even though for FIA also no, they don't consider the home movies as they don't gave the same importance for home movies as the feature films. And it's the Federation for Preservation of Films. So there's a problem there. I think that's my perspective. And since I work in this institution, it's also like for future films, the digital lab, they restore the films from, I don't know, like Buñuel or these big directors. Or so, yeah, we have to stay strong and gave the value of these films in able to continue for further generations, as we have said, and to know how is the time capsule now that these type of films. Yeah, it's hard, but we have to stay strong.
Yeah, I think that's also why it's so important to have a mix of different types of projects and institutions, you know, really small ones that focus on home movies, as well as incorporating home movies into national archives and continuing to advocate for the recognition of them, of their importance at that level too.
Yeah, but, I'm sorry. And yeah, also like in Cineteca, I appreciate the effort that we have made with my chiefs. to stay still from since 2010 till now.
Anyone else have any final words on that or anything else before we wrap up?
I saw there was another question from Thomas Allen Harris, which is blowing my mind that he's on now. That's great.
Yeah, I'll just read that aloud. Wonderful presentation and discussion. I have made a career of remixing my family and extended family home movies, and it has been deeply healing for my communities, as well as helping to shape my commitment to authentic form of storytelling. Wondering how we can make these materials available for youth to engage their collective histories. Yeah, that's a great question.
Yeah,
Justin, do you have any thoughts about that?
Yeah, just a little bit. This is something that we're actively engaging in right now. We found through spinning home movies that, at least virtually in 2020, not only were we getting some of the audience that we would see at some of the live programs we would do, some of those who are old enough to either be featured in the films themselves, but we're starting to see multiple generations showing up in the live chats saying, oh, that's my aunt. Oh, that's my grandma, you know? And it was really cool to have this intergenerational viewing experience playing out and a chance for folks to narrate, which often happens when we replay home movies. But we saw that there's this beautiful combination with the music, with the meta narratives that our artists were kind of, you know, they're really directing, you know, and we are really interested in practicing right now into building a curriculum as like a, using spinning home movies as like an entry point, to really get young people interested in community narratives and archives and music, social history, many of the elements that are kind of happening at the same time during spinning home movies. And to do that, we know that our digital tools have to be interactive. They have to be usable. This footage needs to be able to be remixed and remade. And I'm just as curious as what they will create with it. but to also share with them that the heritage and the context of these images is one place that we hope to start.
Well, I think that's a great place to end. I'm sorry that we have to cut this short. I'm really enjoying having this conversation with all of you, and I hope we can continue it in other forms. I will ask some of my helpers behind the scenes to once again link in the chat to the document that has all of our contact information, all of our email addresses, as well as all the links from this presentation so that you can get in touch with us. And I'm sorry if we missed any last questions that came in, but please do help us keep the conversation going. And I just want to thank all of the panelists really from the bottom of my heart, and as well as Sundance and the Roxie and all of you audience members for joining us and bringing your thoughtful questions and your presence with us tonight. So with that, I'll just hand it over to Kelly to say goodbye, and thank you so much.
All right. Thank you so much for everyone who joined us this evening. This was such an incredibly powerful presentation. I don't know.
Okay, we were worried this might happen. Kelly is actually working at the drive-in right now, which I love because I wish I could be at the drive-in, but this was amazing. I'm glad I was here tonight with all of you. And Kelly, I'll just say goodbye on your behalf and on behalf of the Roxie. I also forgot to mention, so I'll do that now, that there is another program in this series tomorrow night, actually featuring Stephen Gong from Center for Asian American Media, who's Patricia mentioned, as well as Pamela Vatican in her role at California Revealed, in discussion with Bay Area Video Coalition and a filmmaker. So I think I put a link to that in the chat just now. Oh no, I didn't. I didn't do that, but I will do that now. That's tomorrow at 1 p.m. It's called It's Not Lost in the Archives, and I'll be there. I hope to see some of you there too. So thanks again, everybody, and good night.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.